Okay, so good morning, welcome back. So we have completed two chapters in our course, ME5530, Introduction to Atmospheric Science. Now we start off on a very important topic, if not the most important in this atmospheric science, which is atmospheric thermodynamics. So we'll be focusing on thermo D, as we frequently refer to thermodynamics as thermo D, and but the context is the atmosphere, it is the atmosphere of the Earth. You can study atmospheric thermodynamics with reference to Venus, Mars and so on, but our context is atmosphere of the Earth, okay. Thermodynamics is now very comfortable because thermodynamics to mechanical engineers is like playing cricket at the Lords, right. So we went through all this 1 month of descriptive type of lectures and all that, but I try to make it as interesting as possible by interspersing problems. Whenever I felt that there'd be a sag in the interest, every 15-20 minutes, I'll stop the PowerPoint and we have done problems, right? So thermodynamics, there's no need for that. We can just go on and on and on. So we'll have to take a call on where we want to stop. Okay. First we start with gas loss, then we look at virtual temperature. But basically we're looking at moist air thermodynamics, which is different from the thermodynamics which you studied a little bit. The science is not different, but the context is different and the focus is different. Okay. Mechanical engineering students must have already studied the psychometric chart and all that, but since most of you are non-mechanical students, it won't be a repetition for you. It may bring in that much needed alacritic freshness which you are looking forward to any course, right? So we'll start with gas laws, then we'll go to the first law, then we'll go to the second law and apply it to the atmosphere. Anyway, the piston and cylinder will be there. So we'll, without piston and cylinder we cannot hope to study thermodynamics, but we'll restrict the piston and cylinder to minimum. We are not going to solve problems on 4-stroke engine, 2-stroke engine and so on. So thermodynamics is the science of energy. Relationship between heat, work done and the energy, okay. The transformations, okay, which take place, work to heat, heat to work, and if they are not equal, there is something which changes, which is called the energy. This energy can be made more specific by calling it as internal energy plus other energies and so on. This internal energy is a property of the system and all that. We will flesh out all this terminology as we go along. But thermodynamics is referred to as the queen of sciences. Always we say queen of sciences, not king, because some queen is most of the time the queen is far more important. She is the queen of sciences. Some people have said that if all knowledge is burnt, if all of human or whatever human beings have acquired is burnt, only thermodynamics is left behind. We can resurrect the whole knowledge with thermodynamics. Don't say, sir, you will say like this because you are from ME or, but little bit that will be there, but still by and large this is true. So thermodynamics is basically the queen of sciences, and I am not saying this, this is Wallace and Hobbes. We are referring to that book quite a bit. Wallace and Hobbes, okay, very respected atmospheric science professors say that thermodynamics is the crowning glory of classical physics, okay. Okay, it is the crowning glory and one of the cornerstones of classical physics. It is not only the cornerstone of classical physics, it is also the cornerstone of mechanical engineering, because we would like to convert heat to work through the heat engine. Though there are other ways of producing work directly without the heat engine, namely the solar photovoltaic, wind energy and so on, right. But if you look at the automobile, the plane, airplane and all these and engines producing power, in most of these cases, we are able to convert heat to work which reduces human toil and makes human life more comfortable and productive. You can go on and on. I can talk because it is my domain. I can keep on talking about this. We'll restrict our, we'll just close the discussion here that it is very important, and it has got applications not only in mechanical engineering, it has got applications in physics, it has got applications in chemistry, it has got applications in metallurgy, you've got metallurgical thermodynamics, you've got chemical engineering thermodynamics, even thermodynamics and entropy. Entropy is the amount of disorder, right? So there is something called information entropy and all this, which is heavily used in computer science. Okay, we want to minimize the entropy and right information, more information is less entropy and less information is more entropy. There is Shannon's entropy principle and there are so many things where thermodynamic concepts are used. Okay, so thermodynamics is basically a very important subject, and in atmospheric science is very much used. We can solve a lot of problems. We can get a considerable handle on the way the atmosphere behaves if you take recourse to thermodynamics, right? So where do we start? Gas loss. Okay. So the ideal gas equation is PV equal to MRT, okay? Pressure, volume, mass, this is gas constant. Okay. Please forget that PV equal to NRT and moles and all that. Okay, sometimes it may be useful in thermodynamics, in chemistry and all that. But as an engineer, I hate PV equal to, I'm sorry to say, hate that PV equal to NRT, right? Because mole cannot, 1 kg is easy to comprehend. Okay, so your teachers have taught you PV equal to NRT. Please remember that if you want, there's no problem. R is the gas constant. What is this R? R divided by R is the universal gas constant and M is the molecular weight of the gas. For air, sorry, what we calculate, normally it's accepted 28.97, okay. You call it as kg per kilomole, that's what you say, or? But somehow the kilomole is has not gained currency, is it or what? Anyway, 28.97. So that will be joules per kilomole, is it or? Huh? Yeah, you please remember your basic stuff, man. Joules per kilomole. I want this R to be 287. If you don't get that, we'll keep on working, reworking till we get that. Now you just 8314 divided by 28.97, please do it. Huh? Oh. Very good. Okay. Joules per kilogram per Kelvin. It's got the same units as specific heat. Correct? But now I'll have to say that this is MD, molecular weight of dry air. So this is the gas constant of dry air. That means later on I am going to talk about gas constant of moist air. Okay. So where water vapor will come into the picture and so on. Now PV equal to MRT. RT. What is V by M? Rho. What is V by M? Specific volume. What is 1 by rho? PV equal to RT. Meter cube per kilogram. All these are various forms of the ideal gas equation. PV equal to MRT, okay. PV equal to RT for 1 kg, PV by M equal to RT. So, this is specific volume. Correct. Yes. Engineers hate density, so we prefer specific volume. Chemists are so hung up with density. All this is live, man. It's okay. We'll edit it later. We are not hung up on density, right? Our steam table is all specific volume. VF, VG, HF, HG, SF, SG. How many of you use the steam tables? Yes, all of you have used the first year. So it's all specific volume. No density. Okay. Now, whatever you wanted to say, now you say that P equal to 1 by V equal to rho. P equal to rho RT. Okay. This is very good. Equation number 4. So, 1, 2, 3, 4, they are all forms of the ideal gas equation. Okay. How did this come into play? How did they figure out this law? Boyle's law and Charles' law. Okay, there are two guys who just first figured out these two. So, we look at the historical development quickly. I will use the notes to give the year in which this guy was born and okay. So, he is British, both physicist and chemist, Boyle. So, it is okay if you make call him Sir Boyle, right? He was Sir Boyle, I think. So, 1691. So, for a fixed mass of gas, when T is a constant, he figured out that PV is a constant. Okay. Okay. This is very important. When T is constant. You want to use small v or? We will use small v. Okay, some 5. For a fixed mass of gas, so some silly questions will come, balloon is being inflated. volume is also increasing, pressure is also increasing. Is Boyle's law violated? What a silly question. It is not for a fixed mass of gas. Okay. This is a trick question. You don't know this trick question. You inflate a balloon. Is the pressure increasing? Yes. Is the volume increasing? How is PV equal to constant? Is it violated? Silly question. Because it is not for a constant mass of a gas. And also, when we say Hooke's law, what define Hooke's law? Stress is proportional to strain. What a silly answer. Within elastic limit, stress is proportional to strain. Outside the elastic limit, it is not valid. So, you have to be careful. Okay. Precision is very important. All right. So, next is this Charles. Okay. What is his, what should be his nationality? Charles and German, you ask him. No way. No, they don't like. French. Okay. So, so they like Wilhelm. Wilhelm. Wilhelm, Sven, Jens, Marius. Huh? Okay. 1746. Okay. So, what did this guy say? Again for a fixed mass of gas, right? What did he say? When P is a constant? Correct, na? There are various forms. When P is a constant, V1 by T1 equal to V2 by T2, right? Somebody taught you V is a constant, P1 by T1, and that is also okay. We can't contact him now and find out which version is it. But both are, we can derive one from the other. Okay, what is this now? V1 by? Then it is possible for you to combine the Boyle's law and Charles' law and say that PV by T is a constant. And then somebody did a lot of experiments and then they figured out the universal gas constant. All this story you must have studied earlier. Okay. So, let us go past that. Apparent next is, okay. Now, I have to say number of moles anyway, though I do not like it. For the sake of completeness, we have to define what is N, the number of moles. Okay. Is given by okay. So what is this number? 7. So this is also helpful in those cases where you know the molecular weight and for some strange reason somebody doesn't give you the mass but gives the number of moles. Then using number of moles and molecular weight, you convert it to mass and then use it in PV equal to MRP. Is it okay? What is the number of molecules in 1 mole of a gas? Yeah, that is the Avogadro number, right? N is the number, capital N, it is always capital N, right? NA is it? I forgot all this, I did it long back. So, NA is 6 point? Uh-huh. 6.023 10 to the power of 23. Is it okay? So, if you by some strange means you know the number of molecules, then it is possible for you to find the number of moles. If you know the molecular weight, you can get the mass. Once you have the mass, then in PV equal to MRT, if two are known, the third can be found out. That is a silly application of plug and play in a formula. Okay, A plus B equal to C plus D, A, B, C are given, find D. All right, but we will do much more than that. What is the apparent molecular weight in a mixture? We have already seen this. In the first chapter itself, we solved problems where we figured out the molecular weight of air, but we will just formalize this with an expression for the apparent molecular weight. Where mi is the mass of the ith component, this will be mi, no? Correct? Molecular weight of the ith component. Shall we check for the asymptotic correctness of this? If there is only one component, it is m1. m1 divided by m1 by m1, there is no sigma, small m1, small m1 will get cancelled. Md equal to m1, the molecular weight of the single component. Therefore, this formula appears to be correct. All right. Next, okay. What is equation number 8? Very good. Keep all these things in your notes, so when we solve problems, all these will be useful. So we can also call it as m equal to m by total number of molecules. We already did this, right? Numerator will give you kg, denominator will give you kilomole, kg per kilomole, fine. So, Rd, there is no subscript for this, this is a universal gas constant. Again, we turn around and write the 287 again. Okay, so this is basically a 20-minute course on gas laws. So this is the ideal gas equation. Okay, the ideal gas equation is also applicable for individual species in air. So the ideal gas equation should also be applicable for the water vapor present in the atmosphere. Okay, so let us write the ideal gas equation for the water vapor. Okay, for water vapor. Okay. Equation number we'll put it as we'll call this as 9. Hmm? 10. 11. What is RV? 461.9. Very good. RV.
R by MV.
18 kg per kilo mole. Very good.
Joules per
all right. So you can apply this to the individual. RD by RV equal to V87.
Point 622.
Very important value in atmospheric thermodynamics, right? 0.622. We call it as epsilon. The ratio of the gas constant for dry air to the gas constant of water vapor is 0.622. So, we will develop the concepts in moist air thermodynamics or psychrometry in mechanical engineering based on this epsilon of 0.622. All right. Now, we are shifting gears from dry air, Boyle's law, Charles' law, all this PV equal to RT. From dry air, we are now getting into moist air. In moist air, this water vapor is also there. So, who is having a, or which is having a R of 461.9, which is quite different from 287. How to handle this moist air? We should have a framework for handling this, correct? Before that, if several gases are occupying a container, one first law, which is very important, has to be applicable. What is that? Dalton's law of partial pressures. So, you have to get a handle on this, only then we will be able to work out. Without this Dalton's law, we will not be able to proceed further if you are looking at mixture of gases. Okay? So, please take down the Dalton's law of partial pressures. It appears that he is Brit, no? Okay, 1766. To 1844 is also important year. Ludwig Boltzmann was born in 1844. Boltzmann is 1844 to 1906. Okay, so you got the Boltzmann's constant and this thing and distributions, right? Boltzmann has got Stefan Boltzmann constant in radiation. Boltzmann is a stud guy, man, okay, just like Max Planck and others. All right, Dalton's law of partial pressures. The total pressure exerted, please take down, the total pressure exerted by a mixture of gases that do not interact chemically, okay? The total pressure exerted by a mixture of gases that do not interact chemically is equal to the sum. The total pressure exerted by a mixture of gases that do not interact chemically is equal to the sum of the partial pressures of the gases. Oh, this is a bad chalk. So, okay, equation number 15. We are not done yet because we need to know what is partial pressure. Okay, once you know the definition of partial pressure, you can use Dalton's law of partial pressure. And then I am going to introduce a construct. The construct I am going to introduce is, I want to retain the gas constant for dry air itself. I want to stay with 287. I want to stay with 287 joules per kilogram per Kelvin. I know the total volume V and so on. But I know that I cannot proceed further without accounting for the water vapor. Therefore, I am introducing a construct called the virtual temperature. The virtual temperature will correct for the water vapor present in the atmosphere. So, once I have a virtual temperature, then I will go ahead and use the ideal gas equation as though all other things correspond to dry air, and then I will make this virtual temperature correction and do all the calculations. Okay, so we are heading towards that. So the first step was the Dalton's law of partial pressure. Then partial pressure, please take down the definition of partial pressure. The pressure a gas would exert at the same temperature, the pressure a gas would exert, the pressure a gas would exert at the same temperature as the mixture. The pressure a gas would exert at the same temperature as the mixture if it alone occupied. Pressure a gas would exert at the same temperature as the mixture if it alone occupied all of the volume. Pressure a gas would exert at the same temperature as the mixture if it alone occupied all of the volume that the mixture occupies. Okay? So that volume problem is not there because for everything it is a total volume V. Okay? Now we will have to go into this very important concept of virtual temperature. I do not think you have studied this elsewhere, isn't it? Okay. So virtual temperature is an important concept in atmospheric thermodynamics. Finally, in some problems we will tell it, we will say that virtual temperature is same as temperature, but first we should know what virtual temperature is. All right. Virtual temperature, is good Deutsch? Sehr gut. They call it temperature in German. Okay, virtual temperature, TV. Small v, whatever you want. Where is the need for introducing this virtual temperature? Because m of moist air is not equal to md. Okay. Joules, na? R is equal to 287 joules per kilogram per Kelvin is convenient to use. So, we introduce a fictitious temperature called virtual temperature. Now, how do we derive this virtual temperature? Okay, shall we derive this now? Consider a volume V, capital V of moist air at pressure, total pressure P, and okay, P is not good. So, MD is the mass of what is the rho of air? From the data given, what is rho? MD plus MV divided by V. As simple as that. Why does it take such a long time? Yes or no? Of course, it's correct, right? 16, huh? So I'm introducing something called a partial density, okay? Somebody, some teacher taught you the densities cannot be added, so it is partial density, it is some other hypothetical concept, okay. Volumes can be added, density cannot be added, all those principles are correct. What is this partial density? Please take down this definition. I have some definition, okay. Rho d dash, density. Rho d dash is the density md kg of air okay. Rho d dash, the partial density of dry air is the density md kg of air would have had if it alone occupied all of the volume V, correct? The density md kg of air would have had if it alone occupied all of the volume capital V, okay. Rho V dash 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 if mv kg of water vapor, and complete the sentence, okay. The partial density of water vapor is the density mv kg of water vapor would have had if it alone occupied all of the volume, okay. So, What is P? What is PV dash? Very good. Good. 19. P D dash. Rho. R D. T. Very good. Now the key funda is P equal to. Who is responsible for this? Dalton. Okay. So this is Dalton's law of okay. So what is the funda now? Correct. All right. Can you complete this? One minus. Is this correct? I think it is correct. What is RD by RB? Epsilon. That is also 0.622. Substitute for that. So this is now 25. Why all this struggle in life? Sir, what are you doing, sir? That question comes to.
The whole component is the eventual temperature. Why?
No, then you have to introduce that. I want this. That is what I want. Okay. Therefore, is it fine? Correct? So TV is the virtual temperature. See, if you are doing atmospheric thermodynamics calculations, if you know what is the partial pressure of water vapor, or if you know what is the concentration of water vapor in the total, I will tell you in terms of volume. Okay, volume and pressure are the same. You do 1%, 2%, 3%, you can put that 0.02 into 1.662. So this will be a small number. Okay, and then since this is the denominator, TV is always TV is always but even in worst case scenarios, TV minus T is only a few degrees C. We will demonstrate it with the help of two problems in tomorrow's class. With the first problem, I will give an arbitrary concentration of water vapor as 1% or 2%. You will find out the virtual temperature correction. In the second case, we will refer to an old table where the atmospheric concentration of water vapor is there, the lower limit and upper limit. You will apply the upper limit of the atmospheric concentration of water vapor, which is the worst case. Okay? In that case, we will see that TV minus T will not be tens of degrees centigrade, it will be only a few degrees centigrade. Sometimes you can ignore, or you make this correction and use it in your calculations. So this is the way you correct for water vapor in the, instead of working on the gas constant, this thing and all that, you just correct the temperature. There is a virtual temperature. Therefore, we still have 1 minute. Please take down the formal definition of virtual temperature. Virtual temperature is, the virtual temperature is the temperature that dry air would need. Virtual temperature is the temperature that dry air would need. Sorry, correct, but the way I said it is not correct. Virtual temperature is the temperature that dry air would need to attain. Virtual temperature is the temperature that dry air would need to attain in order to have the same density. Okay? Virtual temperature is the temperature that dry air would need to attain in order to have the same density as moist air, in order to have the same density as moist air at the same pressure, correct? As it gets heated, it becomes lighter. Therefore, the temperature from T has to go up from TV so that its density is lighter, so that it matches with the density of moist air. The density of moist air is less than the density of dry air, consequent upon the fact that the gas constant of for water vapor is 461.9 and this is 287. If some few percentage points are there, you will get a gas, you will get a composite gas constant which is more than 287, consequent upon which the density will be lower. So this air has to be heated up by a few degrees from T to TV in order that its densities are matched. Okay?